one and all, and a warm welcome to the next session of the Extramural Lecture Series. I am Pranav Bapat, and it is my pleasure to be your host for this evening. Extramural Lectures is a platform for students of IIT Madras to interact with distinguished personalities from across the globe from diverse fields. We envision to serve as a platform to promote knowledge in multitude of domains, probe the community of the country's top intellectuals to think outside their strict realm of pursuit, and create a free atmosphere of open-ended exchange of intellectual thoughts. To this end, we are driven to host eminent personalities as well as individuals who have shown great initiative towards driving forward change. Therefore, our distinguished guest for today is renowned political commentator and analyst, Dr. Sanjaya Baru. Dr. Sanjaya Baru has been Secretary General at Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry since September 1, 2017. Dr. Baru is Director of Geoeconomics and Strategy at the International Institute for Strategic Studies in Singapore. He is an Honorary Senior Fellow and member of the Governing Board, Center for Policy Research, New Delhi. Dr. Baru is a journalist who was attached to PMO from 2004 to 2008 and is a political commentator and policy analyst. Dr. Baru was the official spokesman and media advisor to the Prime Minister of India and has also served as editor of the Business Standard, chief editor of the Financial Express, and as associate editor of the Economic Times and the Times of India. Dr. Baru holds PhD and master's degree in economics from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. So, it's our privilege to have you here with us today. May I now invite the EML core, Kushal, to welcome our esteemed guest with a flower bouquet. Thank you, Kushal. Now, I would like to request our distinguished speaker for the evening to deliver his much-anticipated talk and guide us, the student community of IIT Madras. Over to you, sir.
Can I close this? Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here this evening. I think I'm coming back to IIT Madras after some 30, 35 years. My brother used to study here. He was in Godavari Hostel. And those days, I used to come here to spend some time with him. But I don't think I've come back to this campus after that. That was probably some 40 years ago. But it's a beautiful campus. I've just driven through it, and you're all very, very fortunate to be here. Bless you. I've been asked to speak by your colleagues who invited me here on the subject of where is India headed. So what I will do is to try and address that question and then leave it for you to ask questions. My experience at such gatherings in the last few years has been that the questions tend to go in all directions, so I'm quite prepared for that. As you've seen from my introduction, I'm a bit of a jack of all trades, master of none. I've been in the media, I've been in academia, I've been in government, I've been in think tanks, I've been in a business organization. The tense used was mostly is, but I was. I'm now retired. All of that was in my past. I now sit at home, read books and try to write books and do nothing more. So let me answer this question, where is India headed? Before I get into that, let me begin by saying something briefly on where we have come from in order to understand where we are going. We were, as I'm sure all of you recognize and know, one of the major economies, I can't use the word nations, there were no nations at that time, but certainly one of the more prosperous, settled regions of the world till around 1700. There's a very famous study by a Cambridge historian, Angus Madison, which you will find on the internet. You can just Google Angus Madison, the world economy, where Madison has tried to estimate national income of different world, different parts of the world over the last 1,000 and odd years. and shows how till around the 17th century, India and China contributed to more than almost 50% of world income. In fact, earlier even more than 50%, but certainly by 1700, 50% of world income. And by 1950, over the subsequent 2.5 centuries, the shares of both India and China dramatically came down. China's from around 26% to 5%, India's from around 24% to 3%. So precipitous fall in the shares of China and India, while a dramatic increase in the share of Europe, Western Europe particularly, and the United States. But over the last century, from 1900 to 1950, the Indian economy grew at about 0%, from 1950 to 1980 at about 3.5% per annum average, and from 1980 to 2000 at about 5.5%, and from 2000 to 2010 around 8%, 8.5%. So you have an economy that is rising after having declined over a fairly long period of time, and rising at a rising rate of annual growth. It is because of this acceleration of the Indian economy's output, this, when I talk of rising growth, I'm talking of national income of the economy, that by the turn of the century, the rest of the world began to recognize that there is something happening in this part of the world which is of interest to the rest of the world. The turning point, and since you're all students of the IIT, you would appreciate that the turning point came with the Y2K problem, when suddenly the world discovered that India had the manpower to deal with the problem. And if you look at the literature of that time, around 1999, 2000, 2001, the Financial Times, the Economist, Western media, Western analytical discourse on international economy was full of questions about, you know, what is happening in India. India was seen in a negative light for far too long a time. Nobody understood that here was a country that was producing a set of talented young people who were able to address a global challenge. And so 2000 became a turning point. But I'll come to 2000 in a while. While this was the economic legacy of this country, of a decline followed by a recovery and an acceleration, the political transition was even more interesting, because this was the first country, developing country, first colonial nation, first post-colonial society that experimented with democracy and succeeded. No other post-colonial nation, no other post-colonial society was able to sustain democracy, though many of them began as democracies, but very quickly were transformed into military dictatorships or dictatorships of different sorts. But India actually worked with a constitution that was adopted by itself through a constituent assembly of Indians who accepted principles that the West took almost 200 years to come to accept. For example, adult franchise for all, irrespective of gender. Women in the Western societies got their voting rights only in the beginning of the 20th century. India began its journey as a democracy with equal voting rights for men and women. There were many countries in Europe, even at that time, which demanded that a voter should have an undergraduate degree or at least a high school passing qualification. We said no, any citizen has the right to vote, and it was universal franchise. So there were lots of things that this country did in adopting a Republican constitution. That was significant. That was as significant in my judgment as its economic recovery. And I think one should not miss out the fact that the economic recovery went along with a political enfranchisement of people. But it took a long time for the West to understand the resilience of Indian democracy. And I'll come to the word resilience in a while. Remind me if I forget to do that. There were articles written even as late as the late 1960s in Western political discourse about the impending breakup of India. John Kirkpatrick, who was actually an official in the Ronald Reagan administration, had an internal paper which suggested that India would break up. And of course, we've had very many reasons why many around the world assumed that India would break up. We had a party in this part of India that demanded separation from the Republic, the original Dravida movement. But we had in Kashmir, you had in Northeast, you had political parties demanding, being no longer part of the Republic. And therefore, there was the assumption that this nation would break up, and India did not. And India survived an emergency. When the emergency was imposed, it was assumed that democracy had come to an end, that this Indian experiment, like the Egyptian experiment, the Indonesian experiment, the Latin American experiment, like all these experiments in the decolonized societies, the Indian experiment has also failed. India has become a non-democratic nation, but the emergency ended and the Indian democracy was restored. So the democratic transition was also an important part of our achievement as we look back at the past. As a consequence of the economic recovery and as a consequence of the political enfranchisement of the Indian people, there was an increasing appreciation of the strengths of this country. But let me draw your attention to two or three formulations about India that appeared in the 70s, which I think are late 60s, early 70s, which are still relevant today as we look around at our country. The first was John Kenneth Galbraith's formulation. John Kenneth Galbraith, economist from Massachusetts, who was a US ambassador to India during Nehru's time, famously called India a functioning anarchy. Paradoxical as it may sound, he said India is a country that functions. There are lots of things happening here. The economy is recovering from colonial rule. There is a democracy that has survived. 3-4 elections have been held. Governments have transited in a democratic manner. And therefore, this is a functioning system. But it's a complete anarchic society. There is excessive freedom. There's no proper rule of law on the Indian streets, for example. And here is a country that, to the outsider, appears as an anarchy. And therefore, he coined this phrase, India is a functioning anarchy. The same idea was captured by Joan Robinson, again an economist at the University of Cambridge in the UK, when she said that every statement about India and its opposite is true. That whatever you say about India is true, but its opposite is also true. And in a sense, it conveys the same meaning that you're a functioning anarchy. And the third formulation was done by a Swedish economist, Gunnar Myrdal, who called India a soft state. That here is a country that has a government, an elected government. It has the state machinery. It has the IPS, the IAS, the Indian Army. It has all the, it has a judiciary. It has a written constitution. And yet it is not able to assert itself against all manner of attempts to go against the law. Criminals become politicians, businessmen get away with not paying taxes, and the state is not able to do much about it. And therefore, it's a soft state. It is not able to impose discipline, law and order, its will on its own people. There's insurgency here. There's, law and order problem there. As Galbraith said, the anarchy around and the inability of the state to assert itself. So these are all interesting formulations that are around the same time, late 60s, early 70s. And I mention this because that was a period in which the real change of the India that we know today is beginning to come about. And what are the sources of that change? The first and the most important was the Green Revolution, a transformation of the Indian countryside. India was a country that had become dependent on imports for food beginning to feed itself. And the first, the most important empowerment of a poor nation is to have the ability to feed its own people, that you are not dependent on the rest of the world to feed your own people. The Green Revolution was a major intervention around that time. The second intervention that happens as a consequence of some of the investments made earlier in a growth of an industrial economy, growth of higher educational institutions. So all the infrastructure of modernity is coming into place. And this is happening around the same time. The fruits of development are beginning to be seen and beginning to be felt. What went wrong? I now draw your attention to a document on which I've just written a book along with Meghnad Desai and a few others called The Bombay Plan. It's now in the market, and this is a commercial break. You can all read it, and I urge you, particularly young people here, to read it. Because the Bombay Plan, as it was popularly known, was a document written in 1944, by a group of business leaders, J.R.D. Tata, G.D. Birla, Lala Sriram, Purushottam Das Thakur Das, Ardashil Dalal, John Matai, who later became finance minister in Nehru's cabinet. All of them came together and wrote this document, which was forgotten, which we rediscovered, I and a couple of others, and we have reprinted it. It's for the first time after 1944, it's been printed again in 2019, along with commentaries on the document, which many of us have written. If you go back and look at the Bombay Plan, and this is written before independence, 44, it's a fascinating document because it draws our attention to two of the biggest gaps in India's post-independence development. First and foremost, education and healthcare. The Bombay Plan says categorically that it is the responsibility of a government of free India, when India becomes free, and clearly that freedom was on the horizon, to educate every citizen. I was just talking to some of your friends before coming into this hall, and we are addressing the question of what is it that distinguishes China from India. And it's, you know, people say, oh, China has these big cities, big buildings, it has X, it has Y. It has an educated population, a universally educated population. All of East Asia, what is it that distinguishes India from all of East Asia? Education. And the Bombay Plan clearly identified investment in education as a national priority and a responsibility of the state, and the Indian state has failed miserably. We have created an educational system that is highly elitist in its orientation, and you have a huge base which is completely rotten. And you know, you're creating students who are not capable of doing anything at the end of their school education. That is a major gap, and I emphasize this because when you actually read the Bombay Plan, you say, look, these guys knew. These guys were drawing attention to this challenge. And they were looking around the world and saying, which are the countries that actually had universal education in 1944? Not the United States, not Western Europe, the Soviet Union. And they were looking at the Soviet experience. These Marwadi Dalal, you know, businessmen, Lala Sriram, Purushottam Das Thakur Das, you know, J.R.D. Tata, G.D. Birla, they were saying, the Soviets have done it, we should do it, educate everybody. And we failed. And we continue to pay the price. We will continue to pay the price well into the next few decades as a result of this one single gap. The second gap is agrarian transformation. Again, something the Soviets and the Chinese did, but many others did around the world, not just these communist states, even non-communist states, the Japanese after the war, the Koreans after the war, many of the European economies, many of the African economies, redistribution of land, and investment in agrarian infrastructure, in marketing, in rural credit, in empowering the farmer, in building extension services, taking science to the field. All of these experiments, we tried. It's not as if we didn't try. If you go back and look at the second plan, third plan period, and the Planning Commission played a very important role. But and of course, the Green Revolution was a great success because it liberated you from dependence on wheat and rice imports. But that's it. Even today, as you read newspapers today, this morning, yesterday morning, what is the big news on the front pages? What is going to be the major factor in the coming elections? Farmers' distress. Agrarian, challenges facing the agrarian economy. The second gap. So, for all the achievements of the post-independence period, these were the two major gaps. So, I've said all this in order to bring you to where we are. Where are we likely to go? Clearly, if you accept my argument that education has been a major gap in our development process, in our growth process, then we cannot really be moving forward rapidly like the East Asian economies unless we focus on education. We cannot be a Korea, we cannot be a Japan, we cannot be a Taiwan, we cannot be even a China unless this challenge is addressed squarely. And therefore, I emphasize the fundamental importance of not just investment but public investment. We are actually going in the opposite direction. We are destroying public institutions and encouraging private institutions. Around Delhi today, you have private universities, Ashoka University, Jindal University, all these privately funded universities charging 1 lakh a month tuition fees. And the public universities, whether it's Delhi University or Jawaharlal Nehru University, are being destroyed, are being deprived of funds. It's true across, this is what is happening in Delhi. The situation in the rest of the country is even worse. You look at the state of public, I started, my first job was as a lecturer at Usmania University. And when I got the job, I was quite proud. I don't know if a young man today will feel proud if his first job was at a university like that. He'll say, I couldn't get anything else, so I took up this job. But I still belong to a generation that was quite happy to take up that job. Not more than 45 years back. Public institutions in education at all levels. If we do not address this challenge, we will continue to produce bright young people like you and export them to Australia and New Zealand and United States, which we have anyway been doing. We'll continue to do that. Because the economy is not able to absorb the capacity we're building at the top without having built the capacity at the bottom. And this pyramid, this talent pyramid that is so necessary in any sector of the economy, manufacturing, agriculture, services, financial sector, construction. You take construction. You have architects who are paid fancy amount of money as architects. And you have labor that is not even fully clothed. I keep saying this in Delhi to my audiences. Walk 1 kilometer from here to the nearest construction site, wherever you are. Wherever I'm speaking in a city like Delhi, there is some construction happening. And you will not find fully clothed construction workers. And if the construction worker is not fully clothed, he's not fully efficient. His productivity in summer, there's too much heat. In winter, there's too much cold. In monsoon, there's too much rain. How do you expect productivity from that level? So, the economic consequences of this neglect are enormous. And this is a challenge we have to address. Agriculture, of course, is in my judgment, a challenge that can be addressed more easily. I think that the possibilities there are amenable to policy intervention. The potential there is amenable to policy intervention. And we have now examples of states which are doing reasonably well, of parts of states that are becoming increasingly productive, and so on and so forth. I mean, there are challenges in some parts of India, but not across the country. The reason I emphasize education is because when you step back and look at the developing world as it was in 1947, and which is why I begin the story with 47, and you look at what is called the South, the Third World, Latin America, Africa, Asia, and you look at the last, 70 years, 80 years experience, and say, which are the countries that have made it, which are the countries that have not made it, and which are the countries which thought they were making it but are no longer making it? You have three categories. So the countries that have not made it are mostly in Africa. The countries that have made it are mostly in East Asia. And the countries that thought they were making it and suddenly are now discovering they may not be making it are all in Latin America. Brazil, Chile, Argentina, Venezuela, each of them in trouble. And you ask the question, what is it that made East Asia take off? What economists call make the transition from low income to middle income and high income. What made it possible, that transition? Education and empowerment of skilled manpower. When you are dependent on commodities, as all of Latin America and a lot of Africa is, then you simply assume that God has given me oil, God has given me bananas, God has given me this, God has given me that, I make money out of that, I don't need to do anything else. The neglect of human capability, of investment in human capability, is a product of the Arab world. Look at the Arab world. Enormous amount of money. But who works there? Indians. Except, I think, in Oman, Arabs don't work in most of the other states. They take home a salary. I'm familiar with Bahrain. I'm familiar with UAE. Everybody gets a pension from the government. You take home salary. You don't have to work. The work is done by the Malayalis and the Hyderabadis and the Goans and the Nepalis now, the Bangladeshis. It's the South Asians who work there because they have oil. So, resource-rich economies, Brazil, resources, Venezuela, oil, all these resource-rich economies, which assumed that prosperity was based on resources and neglected human empowerment, are all in trouble. Or if not today, they will be in trouble. Some of the Arab countries are waking up, they are beginning to educate their people, they are beginning to force their people to work. That process started. It's not as if they have not understood the problem. They understand the challenge. And they are now moving in the direction of what we call human capacity building. But East Asia is the only part of the world where people have been empowered and skilled to be productive. The hunger for knowledge. I wrote in one of my recent columns, I was in China, in Beijing sometime back, we are driving along the road and I saw a big building, lots of students squatting on the steps. They're all steps like this, in fact, almost like this hall. Steps leading to the entrance of a big building. There are literally 100 or more students sitting on the steps. So I asked my taxi driver, is this some kind of a dharna? I mean, some protest going on. I thought some student protest. And he said, no, there's a library, they're all waiting to go in. I said, why? This is an evening library. The library opens. This was around 5 in the evening. I said, this library opens only at 5. I said, no. They are waiting for a place in the library. All the chairs are full. So when those who are inside come out, these chaps can go in. This is a 24-hour library. And the idea of a 24-hour library where kids are, young people, not kids, young people like you sitting outside at 5 in the evening to be able to go in, that's a knowledge society. That is a society hunger for knowledge, for intellectual empowerment, for human capability development. That is what we have to create here. And that, in my judgment, is the biggest challenge. If we do not surmount that challenge, let me tell you, all this talk about fastest growing economy, be world's number 3 or number 4 or whatever, all balderdash. When I was a student, we were told that the role model for India is a country called Brazil. There's a book called The Brazilian Model of Development, which my professors asked us to read. Brazil was held up as an example of a successful developing country. Would anybody say that today? Is a society torn apart? It's a society fighting itself. It's an economy dependent on resources. But 40 years ago, Brazil was a country of the future. Just as China today is seen as a country of the future. Are we likely to be a country of the future? No, if we do not invest in our people. This is the challenge for India. Now let me stop there. I think I've spoken enough. I have some more notes here, but you know, I've spoken for half an hour, I notice, more than that, 40 minutes. But I'll be very happy to take questions. Can I do that?
Resilient democracy.
Yes, I'm glad you reminded me. Thank you. I asked to be reminded of the word resilient. That is one of India's strengths. I shouldn't end on a pessimistic note. I think I've said too many things that make you feel a bit disheartened. So let me end on an optimistic note, and that's what I intended to do. Thank you for reminding me. There's a very famous book. I forget the name of the author, but you can Google, on resilience, which makes this point that strength versus resilience. What is it, you know, when we think of individuals, we ask, are you strong? You know, are you physically strong? Are you mentally strong? Are you intellectually strong? Strength is a positive attribute of humans. We normally tend to use the word even for societies or for economies. Now, how strong is the Indian economy's recovery, etc.? The word strong keeps entering social science discourse and a psychological discourse quite often. And this book makes the point that it is not strength but resilience. It's like the weed that bends when there's a very strong wind and is able to come back. Resilience is your ability to deal with pressure. It is not enough if you're strong, because often you can be strong but you can crack under tremendous pressure, and you people ought to know that better than me. As engineers, you can have the strongest building, but it can come crashing down if the force against it is stronger than the foundations of the building you have built. But if you are resilient, then you have the capacity to adapt to these pressures. And I think the real strength of India is its resilience. So that is, thanks for reminding. I was going to actually end on this point, that whether it's the polity or the economy. And I can now start giving you examples, but I won't waste your time. You take Northeast, you take Kashmir, you take caste problem, you take communal problem, you take any problem that we face. Our ability to deal with these problems is a tribute to our resilience. We are constantly buffeted, you know, as a society, as a nation, we are constantly buffeted. Unfortunately, we have not been buffeted enough by war. I mean, there's a whole social science theory that societies that live through war emerge really resilient. Germany, Japan, you know, in the recent past, but others in the more distant past, that you live through war, you live through tremendous pressure of deprivation, living on ration. Food and the prospect of death at any minute, you come out of it more resilient, right? India has never lived through war, except on the borders. None of us has actually lived through war, and therefore there is this argument that we as a nation are not, you know, capable of facing real conflict, that the conflicts we deal with are not that serious, and we are somehow able to deal with each of them, whether it's caste conflict, communal conflict, linguistic issues, whatever. I mean, we have dealt with them, and we have recovered from them, or we continue to deal and recover from them. But that's an attribute to our resilience. And I think going forward, resilience will be a strength of this country. And there is, in fact, a growing Western opinion. I'm not very sure, confident how far it is well informed. But there is increasing commentary in Western literature now about the possibility that even China, like the Soviet Union, will at some point break under the pressure of its internal contradictions, that it does not have the resilience. And we have some examples to prove it. I mean, the way they dealt with Tiananmen, and now the latest round of student problems, becoming more authoritarian instead of being more accommodative. That when you face problems, a society can be authoritarian or accommodative. And it's the accommodative societies that are able to capture opposition and internalize that opposition. It's the authoritative societies that tend to break up. So that is a positive. But you can be very resilient and operate at very low levels of capacity. If you want to be resilient and operate at high levels of capacity, then education and human capability is absolutely, absolutely, absolutely essential. This country cannot continue to have 72% literacy, to have such low levels of enrollment in schools, to have such third-rate public government institutions, and not make this an issue in the elections, not make this an issue on which people agitate. That cannot go on. So let me end on that note.
You mentioned that the East Asian...
Just 1 minute. Can I have a glass of water? Yeah.
So you mentioned that the East Asian economies were the countries were the only ones which made it in the third world. But say in the case of Japan, Taiwan, or South Korea, all of these countries had heavy American intervention and pumping of money. So wasn't that the bigger factor in making them what they are today?
See, that was immediately after the war. Immediately after the war, the reconstruction, for the reconstruction of economies, there was US investment. But if you even look at post-war reconstruction, the actual spending data, the US spent most of its money in Western Europe. It was basically, see, what was America's biggest fear after the Second World War? It was Soviet Union, right? What followed after the Second World War was the Cold War. And the Cold War was a rivalry between the US and the Soviets. And the US biggest worry was that Europe would fall under the Soviet influence. And all of Europe had very active communist parties, Italy, Spain, Portugal, Britain, France. And therefore, winning over Western Europe was its priority. So even the post-war spending that they did, most of it was only in Western Europe. What Korea got was minimal. You know, Korean economists used to come to India for training till the late 50s, early 60s. They used to come to Delhi School of Economics and the Planning Commission for being trained. We used to train Koreans how to run Korea. It was not the Americans who were training them. Because, you know, we took a very positive role during the Korean War. And therefore, the Koreans trusted India. But the point I'm making is that they were looking at India for help and advice. The West didn't do much in East Asia. Because even the Soviets at that time were not focused as much on East Asia as they were on Europe. So I don't think it's fair to these East Asian societies to suggest that their recovery after the war and their prosperity was because of American support. Certainly, America was a benign power in the East. So America did not do anything to harm them. But if they became what they've become, it was by their own bootstraps that they've come up. And you know, the way they educated themselves, the way they reconstructed their economies, these are war-torn economies. You know? So we have to respect them for what they did for themselves. Yep.
Hello, sir. I saw the recently released movie Accidental Prime Minister. So the movie is really nice from the point of view of presentation and acting. Especially Anupam Kher ji has acted really nice. But from other side, what are the political intentions of releasing this movie on the verge of Lok Sabha elections 2019? Thank you.
There's a website called thewire.in where I have given a 45-minute interview. So after this is over, go log in and see that interview. That's precisely the question that I've addressed. I have nothing to do with the movie. I wrote a book. And you want to talk about the book, I'm very happy to talk about the book, though that's not the subject for this evening, but that is what I wrote. I have nothing to do with the film.
Hello, sir. Here. So you emphasize the role of education in the development of East Asian economies and contrasted them with, say, Latin America or Africa. What do you think of the role of, economic freedom in a country's development?
Well, see, economic freedom is good and something we've earned the hard way. But without the economic wherewithal, without an adequately educated people, without an adequate infrastructure, freedom itself does not produce prosperity. If freedom were to produce prosperity, all of Africa and Latin America should be, many of those countries have a lot more economic freedom than was the case in India. But economic freedom is a necessary, not a sufficient condition for private enterprise development. The basic conditions still remain human capability. You see, because the economy has not adequately provided opportunities for the kind of people we train, and the world is an open market for professionals, we've had this train. There are different views on this, that this is, you know, I remember Manmohan Singh used to call it as a globe, what is it? It's not a brain drain, it's a brain bank. And you're investing in this brain bank and you can draw from it, you know, at hopefully at some future time or date. And certainly in the case of IT, we have been able to do that. That the talent that went out has become a link for the domestic growth of the sector. And a lot of research institutions have come to India, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, etc. But this is the manifestation of exactly the inverted pyramid that we have built, in which we have focused on creating highly qualified people for a different economy, and not created the people that we need for the needs of this economy. That's part of the problem. The second problem is a social attitude problem, you know, which is that nobody wants to actually get into manufacturing. Everybody gets into IIT, then IIM, then finance, and become a manager, and make other people work. Nobody wants to work. You know, this is a major problem for us. Our manufacturing share of value added in manufacturing share of national income has remained stagnant for the last 25 years. At 16%. In 2006, which is what, 12 years ago, the National Commission on Manufacturing Competitiveness Council, under V. Krishnamurti, set a target that by 2020, India's manufacturing share of national income will go from 16% to 20% by 2020. And we are still at 16%. And now this government has said by 2025, it will go to 25%. But there's been no movement. And you ask the question, why is it we have not been able to make in India? That is a challenge. And you're not creating the, on the one hand, the demand, on the other hand, the supply for the growth of manufacturing. Unless the manufacturing sector grows, you will continue to have this software, you know, IT professionals, you know, in a small part of the economy. And then you have agriculture, which is essentially, you know, still very primitive in terms of its use of technology. And as I said, you have construction, which is essentially still very primitive, highly labor intensive, right? So where are you employing the bright young people that we produce? Which sector of the economy? So they all become CFOs and CIOs and, you know, managers, and all the engineering education is wasted.
Hi, sir. You've been stressing on education throughout. So I just want to ask, so why are we not spending more than 2% of our GDP on the basic education? As I understand, from the time of first 5-year plan, the amount of money that we allocate for education has consistently come down. So even when we identify the problem, why are we not working towards it?
That's what I'm saying. I mean, there is no political pressure. It is not a subject that motivates political mobilization. Where is it? Where is it a political issue? After a long, 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 long time, health has now come onto the political agenda, mainly because it has become the most important item of expenditure for most households. You know, this government has launched this Ayushman Bharat, other state governments, every state government is now coming out with various schemes. I remember writing editorials saying health should be a major focus of policy 25 years back, but no political party was talking about health. No political party was talking about education. I mean, even in a state like West Bengal, which had for 30 years a communist government in power, health and education were neglected. The focus was only on agriculture and peasant, you know, tenancy reform, etc. So, no political party focused on health and education, and therefore there was no political pressure. Finally, we are getting political pressure in the case of health. And the reason for that is very simple. You ask any household today, which is the most important source of expenditure next to buying a house or paying your rent, mortgage or EMIs on buying a flat or whatever, housing being number one, number two, or often number one is health. Because it's all private healthcare. And everybody asks you to go and get this test done and that test done, and you spend a lot of money getting various tests done. Healthcare has become such a drag, people are getting into debt. And therefore, health finally has come into political agenda. But education is not yet. In Delhi, we have a government that is focusing both on public health and public education, Arvind Kejriwal's government. Very interesting that their initiatives on health have got more attention than their initiatives on education. I tried to draw attention to it on television recently, but I've not seen any follow-up of that. They are trying to reform government schools. They are trying to, in fact, modernize government schools and get more children coming into government schools, public hospitals, public healthcare. It's only one political party, that too in parts of Delhi, not all of Delhi. But rest of the country, we are all care of Apollos and all these private hospitals.
Sir, you spoke about education as the core aspect of your talk here. Before my question, I would just cite the reports of World Bank or World Economic Forum or UN, which says that within a few years, the labor in most of the developing countries, like 2/3, would be displaced by the technological innovation or capital intensive manufacturing that is happening in the developing world. So a conventional sense of or tool of education that you're speaking about, or that has been in India for the last few decades, might not work. if you look at it, even if you achieve 100% education, the kind of challenges that is emerging from the new technological aspects, like AI or other Internet of Things. So do you feel or do you envision a new kind of education, a redesign of the education as such or all over the nation? And what are your suggestions over that? Thank you.
You see, first of all, any educational system needs constant modernization, not just in India, everywhere. I mean, you see, United States is grappling with this problem, that there are not enough basic science students doing basic science. It's a major issue today in the US, that there are more PhDs in physics and chemistry coming out of China than the United States. You know, you read the latest Economist has a good article on that. So every country faces from time to time the challenge of modernizing its educational system and bringing it up to speed with the needs of the time. And of course, we also have to do that. But you know, frankly, there is somebody out there taking care of that. Because the market forces in this country are addressing those challenges. There are enough number of private medical colleges, private engineering colleges, private IT institutions, private institutions providing training for people to meet that demand. I am worried about basic education. I am worried about the quality of productivity of your construction labor, of your factory worker. You take labor productivity data of China and India. In a given working day, what is the output of a Chinese worker and what is the output of an Indian worker? One third of the Chinese worker. So what is it that you need to do? If you want to even bring in technology, you need people who can deal with technology. You take a simple sector like construction. Construction today is becoming increasingly technology intensive. But to use that technology, you need labor. And where do you have that labor? So my point is, I'm not worried about the top of the pyramid. The top of the pyramid in this country is taking care of itself. I'm worried about the bottom of the pyramid. And nobody is paying attention. Just no political party, except, as I said, Mr. Kejriwal in Delhi. No political party is paying attention to that. And that is what is really the problem.
Sir, I have two specific questions for you. Question number one is related to education, like you have told. But what I feel, along with education, it is also the population of the country that has hindered the progress to some extent, which is in a circle of fashion is also because of the education system only, because if the basic people are not educated enough, they don't know how to plan their family, and also it will lead to a exponential increase in the population as a whole. But sir, don't you feel that the big policy makers that are there in the parliament, they also don't have any specific requirement of education? Or there are chief ministers who have been nominated and made who don't have that basic education that should be there. If people sitting at the top don't have that kind of education, the policies that they will make will be the way designed or will be best of what their knowledge is. I don't think so that people sitting over here or students in various universities at their very education being given, they'll think that, okay, one time I aim to become the president of India or prime minister or chief minister of my state. So if that is not the aspiration of one student, of any student, maybe an economist, maybe a psychologist, maybe a health person who wants to go ahead and become a health minister or a sports minister of the country. So I feel that should be also the aim of the bureaucrats, plus the MPs, the MLAs who are there, that such a designation should also be progressed.
Okay, thanks.
That is one, sir. My second question
is... two. There were two statements and I'll address them. You sit down, I'll address both of them and then we can take others. First of all, the idea that population is a problem is today an outdated idea. The world today is looking at India as one of the few countries where there are people available for the next 30, 40 years. There is declining population in the West and in the East. the Japanese are spending money on teaching Japanese to Indians to, in order for Indians to go to Japan and work there, because there are not enough Japanese to work in Japan. Japan is spending more and more money on teaching its language to those it wants to bring in. All over Europe, the big issue is migration. The economies need people, but the people, local people, are not willing to accept outsiders. That is what is causing the tension. What is happening in the United States? The same issue, right? And which is the one country in the world that has people willing to go out? It's India. And the countries are increasing their quota for Indians. New Zealand has increased its quota, Australia has increased its quota, Canada has increased its quota. You know, and even Trump is not reducing the Indian quota. People are a liability if they are not educated. People are an asset if they are educated. The old view that population is India's problem is no longer accepted by economists. This was a Western view being imposed on us at a time when the West understood that this demographic transition is happening and, you know, all these Asians are going to populate the world. And in Britain, in the US, this was a concern. But today there's recognition of the fact that the global population growth is slowing down across the world. And we may not, we'll have more old people than young people, more people dependent on pension than people producing enough income to generate those pension funds. That's the problem in Japan. That's the problem in Western Europe. So for India, it's an opportunity. But this opportunity is fast disappearing if we do not educate our people. In fact, the so-called demographic dividend, that we have a population in the age group of 20 to 30 that is productive, active, you know, etc., it can be easily, you know, be a huge liability if you don't provide them adequate skills to deal with. Your second proposition is that politicians should be educated. Why? Why should you aspire to be a sports minister? Please aspire to be a scientist. The damn problem in this country is that we have made our politicians our heroes. Every function I go to, the chief guest has to be a minister, otherwise press will not come, otherwise TV will not come. How many of our institutions invite ministers for convocations? I don't know about IIT Madras, but I can tell you most universities today, finance minister has to come, education minister has to come, prime minister has to come, this minister has to come, that minister has to come. Why? Why not a scientist? Why not an educationist? Why not an artist? You know, who are our icons? Who are our, you know, who are people that we should look up to? Why do you worry about the educational qualifications of ministers? They get elected. As I said in the beginning, that is one of the strengths of Indian democracy, that we said universal franchise. Every Indian has a vote. Once you have said universal franchise, you cannot then say, no, no, you can have a vote, but you cannot be elected if you are not educated. You can't do that. So there are two ways of looking at that. But for heaven's sake, let us change this culture of making our political leaders our heroes. They are not heroes. They are ordinary people. And once they are out of office, they are less than ordinary people, I can tell you that. You meet a former politician, a former minister, it's a very elevating experience.
Hello, sir.
Don't you think the politicians, the ministers being educated will help them in making policy decisions?
No, our policy decisions are made by civil servants. We have a permanent civil servant, civil service. That is the whole point of a permanent civil service, unlike the US or other Western countries. We have a permanent civil service. It's their job, and they come through a meritocratic system, they pass an exam, they're supposed to be the ones advising the ministers. Unfortunately, now at the state level, many of these politicians have reduced even civil servants to clerks. But the civil servants have to fight for themselves. We can't fight for them.
Thank you.
You know, this is what I was saying, you know, you asked the question about my book. I keep telling IAS officers, you have the guts to stand up. Of course you'll be attacked like I've been attacked. But at least have the courage to stand up and speak. You are one Vinod Rai. How many Vinod Rais have you produced? One man who has the guts to come out and say something. But unless civil servants are able to stand up to a minister, you will get ministers running the show.
Good evening, sir. I have two questions for you. The first one is, we have been seeing that China's influence has been growing significantly in South Asia, especially because of their economic power. They have been able to give huge funds and grants for infrastructure and etc. So how do you see that India should counter that influence so that we protect our interests? If through soft power, then how? And the second question, if I may, sir, isn't it unfair to compare India with South Korea, Taiwan and China? I think you addressed this question, but I still feel that population is a major concern, and because of that, we can't compare India with such tiny countries. That's all. Thank you.
Well, I'm glad on your first question has been a subject of my research for last 20 years. I was one of the first people to write an essay saying that China is not a military challenge for India, but an economic challenge. In 1999, actually, exactly 20 years back, I was a member of the National Security Advisory Board during Vajpayee's time. And in the board, my argument was that, you know, we're all looking at China's defense expenditure, China's naval capability, military capability, nuclear capability. And I was arguing that what will really be a challenge for India will be China's economic capability. Nobody was listening to me. We had a 30-member National Security Advisory Board. Out of those 30, at least 20 were senior government officials, retired government officials. Nobody was bothered. Nah, China, nuclear, India should go nuclear, we should have more missiles, we should have more bombs, we should have more ships. And what did China do? They pushed you out of every commodity market. And today, your biggest economic problem is a trade deficit of $50 billion per year with China, right? And what is China's influence in South Asia? It sells goods. It sends tourists. What was Chinese influence in Maldives? More Chinese tourists were going there, Indian tourists. So the Maldivians said, "Bhai, Chinese are giving me money. All my hotels are full because of Chinese tourists. These Indians go to Europe, they go to Geneva, they go to Switzerland, they go to, you know, all these Western, they're all still obsessed with the white man. The Chinese come to Maldives." Money power. So I'm glad you asked this question because mine was a lone voice 20 years back. And I have published papers to show you. I've written a book called The Strategic Consequence of India's Economic Performance, in which there's a whole chapter on this issue. I showed in 1999 that every single country from Iran to Japan, except Bhutan and Nepal at that point in time, China had emerged as a bigger trade partner, while 50 years earlier, India was the bigger trade partner for every one of those countries. From Iran to Japan, India was the bigger trade partner in 1950s and 60s, even in 70s. But by 1999, China emerged as the number one, and today even for Nepal it's number one, and probably Bhutan also is number one. So we are number one for nobody, right? We economists were shouting, but the strategic wallahs never paid attention. They were only looking at missiles and bombs. So the Chinese influence in our neighborhood is not a military challenge, is not a military threat. It is an economic challenge, and it's an economic challenge that China has today won. Now, how do we reverse that? By becoming a more competitive economy, by becoming more productive, by having more educated people, by being, you know, more effective in selling what we produce than the Chinese. As simple as that. The economic competition is the only competition between India and China. I still believe that. I still do not accept that China is a military threat for the simple reason the Chinese are not going to cross the border. Whatever they'll put pressure on you, Doklam, Voklam, these things will go on. But for a variety of reasons, these things will go on. The Chinese will never invade you. And in the seas, the Chinese are not such a threat. Who are our friends? You know, one Chinese scholar said to me, there's this string of pearls theory that India is surrounded by Chinese, Trincomalee, Gwadar, and Maldives, and Coco Island, and all this. So this Chinese scholar said, Mr. Baru, look at your pearls and our pearls. Our pearls are Maldives, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan. This is what you say. What are your pearls? Japan, South Korea, Vietnam, Singapore. Where are your pearls? Where are our pearls? Who are our friends around China? And who are their friends around India? There's no comparison. So China is not a military threat. It is an economic threat. It has remained one for some time now. It will remain for some time now.
Hello, sir. Have I answered
your question?
When we are talking about education, isn't that the quality of education which we are talking about, even at the basic level of
Sure. But quantity first, quality later. First, fill your schools and keep children there from class 1 to class 12, from morning 8 to evening 4. Keep them in the classroom.
Teach them something.
Numbers count. Then I agree with you. Quality is important.
Some of the policies realized by this the government of Tamil Nadu for the past few decades, they gave the mid-time meals, and then they gave so many free items, and even they diluted the syllabus so that the students will stay in the school and not be afraid of any exams. Even at till 8th standard, they don't have to pass any exam. Isn't all these criteria reducing the quality of the education system? Then how are we expecting skilled people for all the manufacturing sectors? Even particularly, the political scenarios are there such that they have to accommodate all the caste and the quota system and the reservation system. All these are going to reduce the quality of the system. So all these things, aren't they boiling down to authoritative and accommodative policies? So authoritative is also necessary to build up this the basic need of improving the quality of education and the skills as such?
Yeah, you're right. But you know, I agree. We should pay attention to all those issues. But the point I'm making is, let us first pay attention to the basic issue of numbers. Let us educate everyone. Get everyone into school. Then once you have schools, you have teachers, then you look at quality of teachers, quality of syllabi. Those are secondary challenges. I'm not disagreeing with what you're saying. But I think the primary challenge remains today one of getting children into schools, of having teachers, of having drinking water in schools, of having toilets with water in schools. These are all basic challenges which majority of the people of this country still face. We are blind to this. So let us address those challenges, and of course along with that also look at issues of quality of teaching, quality of students, quality of syllabi. And in any case, as I said, the top of the pyramid is taking care of itself. You now have in this country what are called IB schools, right? International Baccalaureate. What are these IB schools? They are all schools producing kids who can go straight to American universities. The syllabi is geared to American universities. So you go to a school in Pune and then go straight to California for your undergraduates. So the top of the pyramid is taking care of itself. I'm worried about the bottom of the pyramid.
Due to time constraints, we'll be taking our last question for the evening.
Sir, you talked of the hunger for knowledge that you saw in the Chinese, but who do you think, it's a fairly complex issue, so how do you think we're going to tackle that? In the case, almost no one has a personal responsibility for that, so how do you think we're going to go about this attitudinal change?
People like me should talk more and more about these things. I chose to do this today. I've done this in the last several months in different places. You know, if more people agree with me and then go and talk about it and develop a certain consciousness. As I told you, I went on television supporting Arvind Kejriwal for what he's doing for education in government schools in Delhi. We can only do our bit in our own little way. But if more people do that, you create greater awareness. And there is no simple answer to your question. But I do think that the time has come to place education at the center. In fact, I just wrote a column in the Economic Times 2 days back, urging every political party in this election to promise that by 2020, which is what, 2 years from now, sorry, 2022, which is 3 years from now, when India turns 75, you'll have 100% literacy. I'm telling you, it's possible. It's possible if all of you during your summer holidays are sent to villages across the country to teach kids, to teach adults. These are ideas which, when we were growing up, were, you know, NCC, NSS, we used to do these things. Go and spend 2 weeks in a village doing some social service. These ideas have gone away from our political agenda. If every educated graduate of this country can educate just 5 other kids, and you have a mass political movement, you can do it. Other countries have done it. So let me ignite some passion, you know. Let all the IIT students this year spend 2 weeks in the holidays in villages wherever they come from, teach kids, at least to be able to be literate, basic literacy. That's the only way. There's no other easy solution to your... Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your insightful talk. I'm sure that the knowledge you have imparted and the experiences you have shared have left a lasting impact on us and our understanding of the dynamics of polity, policy, education, and economics. As a mark of our gratitude, may I request Kushal to felicitate the speaker with a memento. May I now request you, sir, to kindly leave us a message in the EML yearbook. May I kindly request the audience to stay until the speaker is done. We wish to express our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Sanjaya Baru for this presence here with us today. I take this opportunity to thank all those who have rendered their unfailing support to us in organizing this session successfully. I also thank the audience, without whose presence this session would not have been a success. Thank you. I also thank the audience, without whose presence this session would not have been a success. Thank you.